Hi everyone, my name is Raghav. I'm a PhD student at North Carolina State University. And today I'll be talking about our work on multi-user gesture recognition using Wi-Fi. Now, gesture recognition is a core technology that enables a number of interactive applications in diverse areas, such as gaming, healthcare, and smart homes. Now, recently there has been a new class of gesture recognition systems that leverage Wi-Fi signals. Now, suppose you have a Wi-Fi signal that is generated from a Wi-Fi transmitter to a Wi-Fi receiver. And while this happens, you have a moving human object that acts as a wireless reflector. So now, whenever the human creates a certain motion, there are a set of reflected paths change, and that result in some change in the channel metrics, such as the channel frequency response and the received signal strength. Now, the key property of the change in these channel metrics is that a certain pattern of change emerges for each gesture. So existing approaches essentially train a model on the patterns of change in these wireless channel metrics for every gesture and recognize them. Now, here is a selected list of these approaches where they essentially use different features of the channel frequency response or the received signal strength or the Doppler shift to recognize gestures. Now, the key limitation of these approaches is that they do not recognize gestures of multiple simultaneous users. And now, to address this limitation, we propose a Wi-Fi-based multi-user gesture recognition system that features four requirements. The first requirement is that it should have just minimal training effort, where we just have to train on the individual gestures. The second requirement is that it should be able to recognize simultaneously performed gestures. The third requirement is that it should be able to recognize any combination of gestures, including repetitions, where multiple users can perform the same gesture. And the final requirement is that it should be implementable on commodity devices. Now, to recognize these objectives, we can go about in different approaches. Now, the first approach would be a naive approach, where we would train for each combination. So let us take an example. Let's look at the user on the top right of the screen. And let us say we have like n predefined gestures. Now, this user has a choice of performing any of the n gestures. Now, similarly, the user on the bottom left of the screen also has a choice of doing any of the n gestures. So therefore, for you would have n square number of combinations for which you need to collect a training sample. So this is not a very practical approach, because the number of combinations grows exponentially with the number of users. So another approach would be to just train for each individual gestures and then separate each user's disturbance in the channel metrics from the total channel disturbance. However, since we are dealing with multiple users here, when we have more than three or four users, it becomes extremely challenging to separate each user's contributions with the limited number of antennas. So we propose a different approach called virtual samples. Now, in our approach, we take a real sample, which is a sequence of n overlapping gestures, and then break it up into n different components by a process called segmentation. And then we take the number of segments and some coarse information from each of these segments, and then ask some information from the training data to generate a set of plausible combinations of n gestures, and then we take the features from the training data and fill in this information into these combinations, and we call them as virtual samples. We then compare each of these virtual samples with the real sample and declare the best match as the sequence of the gestures that were performed. So to build these features, we essentially use a human movement model that was proposed recently in MobiCon 2015 by Wong et al. Now, the key idea of this human movement model is that the channel frequency response power comprises of two parts when a human moves. The first part is just a static offset, which is just the contribution of the CFR power for paths that do not change. And it also consists of another set of dynamic paths. These paths are the paths that change when the different body parts move, and each of these paths is represented by a sinusoid, like a cosine function, whose frequency depends upon the speed at which the body part moves. So now we develop three insights from this model to enable our feature collection for multi-user gesture recognition. Now, the first insight is a given set of given combination of gestures essentially can be mapped to a given combination of frequency patterns. For example, let us say we have two users. performing two gestures. Now let's assume that the user on the left moves or has a reflected path that moves at a speed vk, and let us say we have another user on the right side whose movement results in a reflected path that changes at a speed vl. Now according to the movement model, we essentially have one sinusoid for vk and vl, which we call as the primary frequencies, and we also have one sinusoid which represents the relative speed between these two paths, which we call as the secondary frequencies. So therefore, if you have a certain combination of gestures, essentially you have a certain combination of these primary and secondary frequencies. Now the second insight that we find is that any change in the number of moving users essentially manifests as a change in the number of frequencies. To visualize this, let's take the same example, but in this case, let's assume that we have only the user on the left moving and the user on the right remains stationary. Now in this case, we have only one sinusoid arising from the first user. But now, when we have the second user who starts moving, in this case, we have one secondary frequency and one additional primary frequency that is added to the CFR power. So therefore, any change in the number of moving users essentially manifests as some change in the number of frequencies. Now the third insight that we derive is that each gesture can be characterized by its primary frequencies. So let's take the same example and focus on the user on the right who's doing a punch gesture at a speed VL. Now if you were to visualize this gesture in frequency versus time, we can see a band of primary frequencies in the red color in the heat map. So this serves as a signature for the specific gesture, and so we can just use the sequence of primary frequencies as features for each gesture. Now let us now see how we use these insights and the model and build our system. So essentially our system comprises of two parts. The first part is the training part where we train the system for various gestures, and the second part is the runtime where we do the actual recognition. Now in the training part, essentially we collect a number of CSI streams over time and then denoise them to remove phase noise, and then essentially perform frequency extraction. Now the frequency extraction is done by a short time Fourier transform using a sliding window, and here we, so if for a given training sample we have a number of windows, right? So from all these windows we extract two pieces of information. The first piece of information is a coarse grained information where we essentially collect the average power of each frequency across all the windows, and we call this as the coarse frequency model. And we also extract fine grained information which we call as frequency separation, where for each window we extract the primary frequencies. Finally, we store both of this information into a training database. Now the core part of this training phase is the frequency extraction, and the frequency extraction has these two steps where the coarse frequency extraction is very simple. So the key contribution would be the frequency separation method. Now for performing the frequency separation, we divide this problem into two sub problems. The first problem is, given an STFT window, how do we find the number of primary or secondary frequencies? So first, we use a dynamic threshold to reject all those frequencies whose magnitude is below a certain threshold. And then from these non-negligible frequencies, we perform a bijection search to get the number of primary and secondary frequencies as k plus k choose 2, where k represents a number of primary frequencies and k choose 2 represents a number of secondary frequencies. So for example, in this figure, the number is 3. Next, we try to separate the primary and the secondary frequencies. So to do this, we first select the top k plus k choose 2 frequencies. In this example, we choose the top 3 frequencies. And then we select a possible number of candidates for k and the remaining as k choose 2. Now this represents a possible combination of primary and secondary frequencies. And for each set, we perform a penalty scoring. The penalty scoring is essentially a method to quantify how well a given set matches the actual definition of primary and secondary frequency. Now we define this as a Euclidean distance between the absolute pairwise difference of primary and secondary. Now the rationale is, when you have k primary frequencies, the secondary frequencies are essentially the relative speeds. So therefore you must have them as the pairwise differences. So we then select the set with the least penalty score and choose the set k as a primary and the kc2 set as a secondary, and store only the primary frequencies as the finer grained features for our training model. Next, we move to the runtime. So in the runtime, we essentially do the same process where we get the CSI streams and remove the phase noise. And next, we do four steps. The first step is segmentation, where we define the ingesters into n different groups. And then we generate, do the combination selection, where we generate a plausible combination of ingesters. And then we generate a virtual sample for each of these combinations, and finally perform the recognition. So let's look at the segmentation process in detail. Let's say we get a sequence of STFT windows. So the first step is to again use magnitude thresholding to detect a sequence of just start and end, a sequence of windows that highlight the number of different number of gestures. Then the second step is to do gesture timing, where we try to identify some gesture started or some gesture ended within this sequence. Finally, we do time pairing, where we match each start and end event as the start and end of a specific gesture. Now let us look at the gesture timing in detail. Now for gesture timing, we use insight 2, which is that change in the number of moving users causes a change in the number of frequencies. So let us consider a plot of time versus the number of frequencies for a segment where three gestures were performed. Now for this, we maintain two variables. One is the number of frequencies in each window and the exponential moving average of this value. Now let's say at time zero, a gesture started and we have the number of frequencies fairly constant across time 1 to time j minus 1. And let this be the first gesture represented by a red color. Now, at time j, let's say a second user starts performing a gesture, and at this point, there is a sudden rise in the exponential moving average. And at some future point k, when the second user stops performing the gesture, the exponential moving average starts falling down. So therefore, we essentially use a rapid rise in the exponential moving average as a flag for the window where some gesture was started, and a rapid fall in the exponential moving average as some time where the gesture ended. Now, the quantification of this rise and fall can be seen in our paper. And the next step, I'll move on to the time pairing, where now, given the sequence of start and end activities, the problem is to now find a pair of start and end times for each gesture. So for this, we leverage insight 1, that each gesture adds certain amount of frequency patterns to the CFR power. So to do this, we first quantify the contribution to the total frequency, to all the frequencies at each start and end point, and then we match two points with the closest contributions. So this can be well understood by a simple example. Let us say we have one gesture, let's call it red, represented by the red color, that starts at time 0 and moves on till time L. And let us say we have another overlapping gesture that starts at time j and ends at time k, and let's indicate it by green color. And in this case, we have red and green both overlapping, so we show it by a green colored hatch on a red background. So now, the idea is, for every start event, you essentially take the coarse frequency model and then subtract it from the coarse frequency model at a previous neighbor, and for an end point, you essentially subtract the coarse frequency model at that point from the next neighbor. So in this example, let's say at time 0, I take the coarse frequency model at 0, and this is the absolute beginning, so we don't have anything to subtract, so we get the coarse frequency model as red in color. And then at time k, this is the time j, this is the start event, so we subtract the model at time j with the predecessor at time 0 and get a coarse frequency model in green. So we do the same thing for time k, where we subtract green hatch minus red to get green, and the same thing for L. So essentially, we get two coarse frequency models of red in color and two coarse frequency models of green in color. So we essentially take the time points of each of these as 0, L for gesture 1, which is a red color, and j, k as gesture 2 for green color. And we also take the average of these two, because we can use this in the next step of combination selection. So the next step is combination selection. Now the problem is that we're trying to solve here is, if we have n gestures in our data set and u users, we essentially have n power u combinations. So the solution is to find potential matches by using this coarse-grained information of coarse frequency models. So to do this, let us follow up from the previous example, where from the runtime we got two coarse frequency models for time period 0L and JK. Now let's assume that in our database we have trained coarse frequency models. Let's assume that there are three gestures, one represented by red, one represented by green, and one represented by pink. So let's assume that the coarse frequency models for red and pink are slightly similar, and they are different from green. So the idea is we max normalize the coarse frequency models from the training set and the real sample, and then we try to match the coarse frequency model from the real and from the trained model and try to guess what could be a possible combination. So in this example, let's say we have red on the top, and then on the side we have pink, green and red. So when we compare, we use a magnitude differential, and the details can be found in our paper, but the essential crux is that we compare the red with the pink and they are similar, so we take pink as a possible candidate. Red and green are not matching, but red and red matches, so we have two possible candidates for the first segment, and for the second segment we have only one candidate. Now, as the last step, we essentially take a Cartesian product of these as the possible combinations. So in this case, we have two combinations, pink and green and red and green. Now, the last step is to generate a virtual sample, which is given a combination of n gestures, we need to generate a virtual sample. So to do this, we take the pink and green set and get the primary frequencies. The next step is we adjust the duration of these windows according to the real sample, and then we extract the secondary frequencies and add them into these samples. And finally, we generate a binary vector, which essentially quantifies the presence or absence of a certain frequency. So now we have two vectors for time period 0L and JK, which we finally do a bitwise OR and generate the final virtual sample as a binary frequency vector. Now, we come to the last step of recognition. The problem is to essentially find the best match between virtual samples and a real sample. So in this example, we have two combinations. So let's say we have two virtual samples. Now, let's say we get a real sample. Now, for this real sample, we first have to convert this into a binary vector again. So to do this, we use magnitude thresholding and set those frequencies that are above the threshold as 1 and those that are below that as 0. So we have a binary frequency vector, and then we use Jaccard coefficient to measure the similarity. So let's say we have these two. In this case, we have the second one at 89% with the highest similarity, and we then declare the combination with the best match as the sequence of gestures that was performed. So we now move on to the evaluation. We essentially employed 10 volunteers in our data collection, and we had up to 6 simultaneous gestures. We chose these gestures from prior works that also do gesture recognition, and we tested our scheme in a 16 feet by 25 feet room, where we placed an access point and a receiver on a table separated by 5 feet. We then collected 10 training samples for each gesture from a single user, and then we tested our scheme for 3 combinations of 2 to 6 users, where we had at least one combination where the same gesture was performed by all the users. Finally, we divided our set into 2 parts. We collected 600 samples where all the users performed these gestures in parallel, and we also had another set where the users performed these gestures sequentially, but the end point and the start point of 2 successive gestures would overlap. So we now look at some results. The first is the segmentation accuracy. And here we plot the number of gestures in a given sequence on the x-axis and the accuracy on the y-axis. And we observe that the accuracy is close to 100%, but in some cases it drops down to 97%. And the reason for this is that in some cases, especially in the parallel case, the start time and the end times overlapped completely. And the one way to solve this is to use a higher sampling rate so that we can get enough time resolution to reduce this error. The second evaluation that we did was to study how well we reduced the total number of combinations. Now, in our data set, we had 6 gestures. So for NA users, the total number of combinations is 6 power NA. So we plot the ratio of the number of combinations that we generate to 6 power NA. And we observe on the x-axis, we have NA, and on the y-axis, we have the reduction ratio. And when we plot the box plot of these, we see that the baseline for at least 2 users, the number of combinations was reduced by at least one order of magnitude. And this reduction increases with the increase in the number of users, which is interesting. And then finally, we study the recognition accuracy. So we essentially divide the data set into 2 parts. We test it on the sequential gestures and test it on the parallel. And if you see, the pattern is similar for both of them. The accuracies average around 95% for 2 users and around 91% when it goes up to 6 users. So the accuracy reduces slightly as the number of users increase, and the reason for this is that the quality of the virtual samples degrades slightly as we move forward by increasing the number of users. So finally, we discussed the limitations of our approach. Now, this was mostly a proof of concept approach, so we do have limitations. The first is that we do not assume that there is any background movement. That is, all users perform movements that are predefined. And the second limitation is we use a simple classification approach of Jaccard similarity. We could have used a more complicated machine learning algorithm for the classification, but our goal was to just demonstrate the use of virtual samples for multi-user active gesture recognition. The third limitation is our system can be sensitive to changes in the user orientation. For example, if you train in a specific orientation and then test it in a different orientation, the speeds of these paths can change. And the fourth limitation is our system can only identify a given set of gestures, but it cannot really identify who performed what gesture. And the last limitation is that our system cannot recognize continuous gestures. That is, users have to take a brief pause before they perform another gesture. So, thank you very much. And if you have any questions, I'd be glad to take them.